Thank you. Thank you. outside. white face. Try not to have to spread me around you.
We thank you for your daughter, Son of Jesus, who hung dead and died, and he Now, while we thank you for the life of Sister Mother Bernadette, who kept her family, thank you for prayer. Now, my wish is to serve and have good way, folks, in the name of Jesus. And I realize that we didn't do it for the night of joy coming home. But it's on this pastor, they will touch and bless the Lord in the name of Jesus. And God be near the praise. God be near the honor. And God be near the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank God. Thank God. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Some of my nieces, that we got an additional number of years with mom that we may not have gotten. And so on behalf of our entire family, I would like to thank you all of my sisters. And we can't leave out Michael, because Michael's put a lot of effort into keeping the family together and the people that work with him. Back in 2006, my sister Jelaine passed away. I was living in Baton Rouge at the time. And I stood right here and said that I never left Baton Rouge with her home as my destination. every time we talked, it was on chance meetings. And I went on to say that if you believe that a big part of life is about building precious memories, then you will realize also that you cannot build precious memories on chance meetings. So with Mom, it was different. We were all around her. Even the great-great-grandkids, we were all there. So how often is it that someone lives long enough to get to know all of her grandchildren, all of her great-grandchildren, and many of the great-great-grandchildren spent enough time around her that they will remember her? So we have just mountains of precious memories. So how do we move forward from here as a family? First of all, we're going to have to cling to one another, and we're going to have to come to realize that we cannot move forward without one another and without our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And so with that, we must cling to one another. We must remain a strong family, and we must trust and care and look out for one another.
Since Pro Paul has all been met to the pastor, Pastor Marie does music in the house. I would just like to speak a few words about my mom. Some went back, raised 17 children. After my dad died, she had the task of raising the rest of them by themselves. She signed the papers for me when I was 16 to get married. And I left home, but I never forgot my mom. I was always backwards and forwards. I've seen my mom work hard. She had to pack water from the ditch to wash clothes. She had to hang clothes on the line before the clothes could get on the line with their clothes. That's how much she cared for her kids. To pack water from a ditch when she didn't have running water. To wash clothes. And we thank her for that, for all the hard work that she put in. And as Deacon Morgan said, he tried to do our garden. So last year, I tried to plant the collard plants. So I got down crippled, and I couldn't see up, and so we had to pull them up. So she enjoyed rolling to the porch, looking at the garden out there. And I also would like to say that she had an open heart surgery in 2012. She never spent one night in that hospital by herself. There was somebody there with her every night when she went to the rehab. Somebody was with her every day and every night. And then this year, we would go every night. We took our turns going to stay with her every night. Somebody in the daytime, somebody at night. So this time she got down, she would always call on Vernon. I would go down about 10:30, 11 o'clock. I said, well, I'm just going to wait until it's time for her to go to bed. So sometime I wake up, I'm asleep. Then I look around, she's asleep. But just to be present there with her was a joy to be with my mom. She's going to be greatly missed. I'm going to miss going down there cooking for her at night. She'd eat late at night. She said it didn't matter how late she ate. But I started cooking food at home. Then I said, no, I'm just going to go to her house. And that way I can spend more time with her. But she is going to really be missed. Really, really be missed. And we'd just like to say to all the people that didn't come, we understand the situation, that you have us in your prayers. And to Pastor Gurley, we thank you for taking the task to come and do the eulogy today.
Good evening, I'm Dr. Shelby Garrett. New beginning ministry, I'm Merle's husband, for those of you who don't know. I've known mother-in-law over 50 years as well. He's the oldest son-in-law, and I came on board. But I want to say that we have a good relationship. And she's not like a lot of people that say that they love you and don't show it. Some people don't know love is an action word. She showed me that she loved me, and I showed her that I loved her. There was a man that had some friends, and the man got sick, and the friends didn't go visit him. So the man passed on, and one day, a month later, one of the fellas was going to the graveyard to see the friend, and he had a bouquet of flowers. And as he walked, he passed by the other friend's house, and the friend said, well, where are you going? He said, I'm going down to see John. He said, well, hold up a minute, I want to go with you. So the man came out of the house with a pot in his hand. And the man with the flowers said, what's in the pot? The man with the pot said, it's soup. The man with the flowers said, John can't eat that soup. The man with the soup said, if John can smell them flowers, he can eat the soup. The moral of the story is, give people their flowers while they can smell them. Tell somebody what they mean to you. Show them that you love them. Mother-in-law was excellent because I ate a lot of time before the rest of the family. I hate to bring that up right now, but sometimes when mother-in-law would cook, when Merle finished cooking, the first thing mother-in-law would say, fix Shelby something to eat. So I ate before Merle. Let me just say this, since we keeping it real. It wasn't a sacrifice for me every Sunday for my wife to go over and spend time with her mom. Through the week, she would go. It wasn't a sacrifice. It was not a sacrifice. I loved her mom, and she did as well. So I just want to let that be known that I was alone. I was by myself every Sunday. Sometimes two or three times through the week, I was by myself. But to me, she was a faithful servant. The Bible says in Revelation 2, part B says, be thou faithful unto death, and I will give you a crown of life. Mother-in-law is wearing a crown. There's five calls in life. There's a call to be born. You and I didn't have anything to do with that. That was our mama and daddy's meeting. There's a call out of darkness into the marvelous light. This is where you can do something for yourself. Now, the third call is the call to death. The fourth call is the call to the resurrection. And the fifth call is the call to judgment. Because the Bible said there is appointed unto man once to die, and after death comes the judgment. Good news is, if you handle the second call right, which is the dark out of the darkness into the marvelous light, when the fifth call comes, which is the call to judgment, your case is handled out of court. Mother-in-law's case is already solved. It was handled out of court. The Bible says, absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. To live is Christ, but to die is gain. That means that while we live in for Christ, and after that breath leave us, then we go to be with Christ. She reminded me of a soldier as I go to my seat. A soldier, he learns how to put on his uniform, learn how to handle his weapon. And the word of God teaches us how to do that, because it says, put on the whole armor of God. When mother-in-law accepted Jesus Christ as her personal Savior, she became a soldier for the Lord. And I can hear her singing right now, saying that I promised him that I would serve him until I die. I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. Yeah, she died in the field of battle. And one thing about a soldier, whenever you have a mission, and if you get wounded, you have to stay on the battlefield until you get orders to come on home. My mother-in-law got wounded years ago when she had to, wasn't able to do the thing that she used to do. She was wounded, but she stayed on the battlefield. She was in the wheelchair, and she got people to roll her here to the church. She stayed on the battlefield for the Lord. But the other day, yes, she got her orders. Come on home.
Good morning. So I just wrote a little tribute to my grandmother.
Since the day I lost you, things haven't been the same. Precious memories is all I have, and room in my heart they will remain. I often lie awake at night when the world is fast asleep. I take a walk down memory lane as tears fall upon my cheeks. As your eyes begin to look towards home, the place beyond the sky, you knew that it was time, that it was time to say goodbye. I'll look for you in rainbows, or even in a song. I'll never forget the day God called home. God looked around his garden, and he saw his face. He then looked down upon this earth and saw your tired face. He wrapped his arms around you and lifted you to rest. God's garden has to be you, because he definitely took the best. It's always sad but comforting, as I remember your beautiful smile. I find comfort in knowing that I'll see you after a while. He knew that you were tired and knew you were in pain. He knew that you would never get well on earth again. Although I want to question and ask God why, but instead I'll be patient and wait for an answer as the years go by. I wish I knew that morning that God would call your name. In life I loved you dearly, so in death I was the same. You were so sassy and said whatever came to mind. Like you never let me forget the time I cooked the eggs and rice and threw the rice in the skillet wrong. Yeah, I never did that down. I remember the night before you passed, you said you were ready to go home. I had no idea you were talking about your heavenly home. Well, the chain has now been broken, and things won't be the same. I'll see you again soon, Mama, whenever God calls my name. Amen.
It was 2013 when she had a bypass. I'm not gonna say much. I'm gonna miss this lady. We fought so much. I would go over that night and knock. She ain't open the door, so I know it's on over there next. This after a fight. So I go over there the next morning. Mom, I know you heard me knocking. I ain't hear you knocking. You still mad? Nope. We just bump heads all the time. I'm gonna miss it. She come back today. We still gonna bump heads, but I'm gonna do a whole lot more. And I'm gonna tell anybody who has parents still living, do your part. Not only do your part, but take up that other person's part if you can. Because it's gonna be a time when they're gonna be gone. This is something I knew was. I didn't know what was going to happen. I never wanted to happen. I want nobody to go. But I'm going to miss this lady. And I want to play, I know we have songs, but I want to play this one song. She told me a few weeks ago, she said, if I can listen to this same song all night, this is the song I will listen to. And I told her, I said, well, Norma can make you a CD with that song on it. So I want to play this song one last time. I'm not singing, I want to play it. And like I said, this is a song she listened to every night before she went to bed. And after the song, Brother Jamal will be coming up for the pastor.
Well, hang on. I'm going to play you the song that they sing. I like to sing this song because this is the song that they sing when they carry my mother away. I can see the crowd as they gathered, starting to hurry from up the hill. And somebody from the crowd begin to sing, oh, dear. Oh, my God. My God, to thee. That's what they were saying. They said, near, a little nearer to thee. They knew she was going home and they said, near, oh, nearer, my God, to thee. see on that mouth saying, Never, Lord, to thee. And then I heard somebody in the loud voice, and he began to say,
Away. Watch out, watch out. won't have to cry no more. Come on, I can say you won't have to cry no more. Good to be all over you. You won't have to cry no more. When you reach the other shore, God promised me joy and peace. All is weary, he's gone away, he's gone away, he's gone away. All of my tears away, hey, hey, wait a minute. Wait,
next, we have Sister Bales coming for the acknowledgments of the individual.
We are so sorry for your loss. May God grant you peace and comfort during this difficult time. You are in our prayers and hearts. Love you, MCH family. May God grant your wings, take flight and soul with angels. We will miss you dearly. Rest in power. With all your daughter and grandchildren, Jackson, Mariah, and great grandchildren. We're missing you, Mom. We will forever be in your hearts. Your daughter, Merle, son-in-law, shall be a great grandson, Kingston. We will always love you, Mom, your daughter, Norma, grandson, Danielle, and great grandson, DJ. Beloved memory, Darren Wilkins. Beloved memory, your family. Beloved memory, Fuzzy. Beloved memory, Freedom and Quiet family. Beloved memory, your granddaughters, Tay, Jasmine, and Mariah. With deepest sympathy for the loss of your cousin and big sister. From the Cipriani King family, David, Fred, Lynn, Ronnie, and Edward, our prayers are with you. With deepest sympathy, Peter and Geraldine Dunn of Clinton, Louisiana. With deepest sympathy, Clifford and Dorothy Bell Wingate. With deepest sympathy, Victor Cousin. With deepest sympathy, Pastor Garrett and the New Beginning Ministry, the church family. Our thoughts and prayers are with you, OCO Church of God in Christ. Our thoughts and prayers are with you, Travis, Trey, and Bryce. Our thoughts and prayers are with you, Gwen, Williams, and family. Our thoughts and prayers are with you, Pastor Nigerius Gurley, Pleasant Valley Missionary Baptist Church, family. With sympathy for the loss of your mom, her voice will echo in memories, your hope. You hope, her smile will warm your thoughts through stories you told. Her love will touch you in spirit each day. Her love will be treasured in beautiful ways. Praying you're comforted by memories and pale clothes and eyes of love as you breathe. Love, shalom, and bless you. A journey remembered. As some people journey through life, they leave footprints wherever they go. Footprints of kindness and love, courage and compassion, humor and inspiration, joy and faith. Even when they are gone, we can still look back and clearly see the trail they left behind. A trail bright with hope that invites us to follow. Praying you will be comforted with precious memories and God's presence to care for you in your loss. Sympathy and love, our brother, our family. There are certain people who touch the lives of those who know. They know in a unique way. Knowing them brings us joy and inspiration. And when they're gone, memories of all they've done stay with us. Your loved one was one of those people to me. I'm grateful to have known such a special person. With sympathy and understanding, we would spend. This is the obituary. For I know that the Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and thine eyes shall behold, and not another, though my brains be consumed with me. Job 19:25-27. Mariah Bell James, pronounced Mariah, was born on January 13, 1929, to Lake Gilbert and Corinne Granville in Osceola, Louisiana, present day Unitas. She was the youngest of five children and an only daughter. She attended Union Charter School, Osceola, Louisiana, graduating from the seventh grade in 1943, which was the highest grade attained by the region for people of color at that time. Her last living classmate is her brother-in-law, James Johnson. She was baptized at the Pleasant Valley Missionary Baptist Church in Osceola, Louisiana, where she served as the Secretary of Sunday School under the late Reverend Joseph Bazoo. She also served as an usher under the late Reverend A.J. Manning. She was a faithful servant, attending church and prayer service regularly. On June 7, 1947, at the age of 19, she married her school sweetheart, Fred James Jr., and remained married to him until his untimely death in March 1975. From their union, 17 children were born, which included two sets of twins. During her lifetime, she was a homemaker, a business owner, a friend, and an active voter. In June 1995, she wed Lucius Brumfield Sr. On Thursday, June 18, 2020, at approximately 10 a.m., while at St. John Parish Hospital, the angel of death plucked another one of the flowers from God's glorious garden. She leaves the cherished remains of her husband, Lucius Brumfield Sr. of Louisiana, the news of his name, with five sons, Carl, Benny James, Sr., Leanne James, Albert, and LaShawn James. Ricky and Beatrice James, Senator of Venus, Louisiana, and Fran Yolanda James of Folsom, Louisiana. Eight daughters, Wilson, Calvin, Vernon, Patricia James, Sherry James, Verna James, Norma James, Edna Maddox, and Jonathan James of Venus, Louisiana, and Ronald Shelby Garrett, Folsom, Louisiana. Five sisters-in-law, Ethel Bell of Venus, Louisiana, Joyce James of Covington, Louisiana, Naomi Johnson of Bailey, Louisiana, Almeda Johnson of Warner Robins, Georgia, Carlene Carrie E.B. Tisdale of San Diego, California, her brother-in-law, James Mency,
John's in Las Vegas, Nevada. And Bishop Lundy was also like a sister to me. Two goddaughters from Thompson, Louisiana, and Melissa Palmer, as well as 50 grandchildren, 108 great grandchildren, and 27 great grandchildren, great great grandchildren, seven stepchildren, and a host of nieces, nephews, cousins, and other relatives. She was preceded in death by her parents, Lorraine and Gilbert Mill. Her first husband, Fred James Jr., two sons, John Lee and Austin Lewis, Sweet James, two daughters, Corinne A. and Jermaine James, four brothers, Joseph J.T., Arthur A.C. Sr., Wilbert R.T. Sr., and Gilbert Bell Jr., nine grandchildren, a son-in-law, Carly Maddox, and a daughter-in-law, Maxie James.
The dream that I dream of my heavenly home, and I know that I'm going there one day.
Take your time, son.
Oh, Lord, baby, morning,
right,
I don't know just how soon, because I'm sitting all of my temper,
all right.
Each and every day. Said I'm sending up my timber on up to glory every day. There's a major somewhere up in glory. That the Lord has prepared for me. Maybe morning, night or noon, I don't know, children, just how soon, because I'm sending all of my timber each and every day.
Amen.
Amen. Luke chapter 12. Father, in the name of Jesus, God, we thank you for your grace and your mercy. God, we thank you, God, Lord, for your love and kindness. And Lord, we thank you, God, Lord, for giving us another opportunity, Lord, to celebrate your goodness and your mercy. Lord, we pray today for the James family. Lord, right now in the name of Jesus, that you would give the peace, God, that surpasses all of us. Lord, thank you, Lord, for pray for you. In Jesus' name, amen. Luke chapter 12, verse 22, and it says, and he said unto his disciples, therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your own life, what ye shall eat, neither for the body what ye shall put on. The life is more than meat, and the body is more than raiment. Consider the ravens, for they neither sow nor reap, which neither have storehouse nor barn, and God feedeth them. How much more are ye better than the fowls? And which of you, when taking thought, can add to his stature or cure? If ye then be not able to do that thing which is pleasing, why take ye thought for the rest? Verse number 31, but rather seek ye the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. I'm going to talk for a little while from the subject, don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. I discovered, as I know that you have discovered, that worry is so easy to do. We find ourselves, you know, we worry about our children, whom we have imparted good values and standards in which they live. We worry if they are out making the right decisions. We worry so much about our kids that when they're out having a good time, you don't get any sleep until you see them walking through the door. Finances will worry us. We will do all that we can to provide for our family. We work two or three jobs just to ensure that we meet ends meet. And end up we scratching our heads trying to figure things out. Some of us, we worry about our appearance. You know, you spend most of your time and your effort trying to be a brick house. Yeah, that we find ourselves stressing out about things. Or some of us find ourselves in this position we are in too often, that we lost someone of great importance in our life and we don't know what to do. I found out that trouble will always trouble us. And have you ever been so worried or stressed out that you didn't know if you should be coming or going? Trials and situations will stress you out to the point to where you are ready to throw in the towel and just give up. One can be so worried and stressed out that they will quit on themselves. Listen, you can be so burdened down and weighed down by the storms of life that it will cause you to give up on you. You begin not to care what happens. You begin not to care where it happens or how it happens. You have your mind made up that if it happens, it happens. Because stress can cause you to shut down. You used to be this upbeat person. Now life has beat you up. You've taken so many losses, and now you seem to be this beat up person. It's because stress has caused you to do some things that you would not ordinarily do. There's this old wise saying that states that worry often gives small things a big shadow. We spend most of our time worrying about things that are outside our control. And we have to come to know that whatever happens will happen.
happens, no matter if we worry or not. This is why the serenity prayer is something we should all ask God for. Lord, grant me with the serenity to accept the things that I cannot change. Lord, grant me with the courage to change the things that I can. And Lord, above all, give me the wisdom to know the difference. How can we get to the place to where we're not worried, but we're happy? The first thing I want to look at in the text is that Jesus tells us, don't worry. He says in verse 22, then he says to his disciples, do not worry about your life. He said, don't worry about what you eat or what you will put on, because we find time to worry about materialistic things. And yeah, this is a materialistic world. There ain't nothing wrong with having nice homes and fine cars and big bank accounts. But we worry more about what we have on our bodies than what we have in our head. We worry about what we have on our bodies than what we have in our hearts. I must stop here and say that the only way we can celebrate the life of Sister Brunfield is because she focused on what she had in her heart. The Bible tells us what profits the man to gain the world but lose his soul. Listen, in order to come back to issues of life, we have to know that what's in our heart is more important than what's on our body. Listen, David said it like this. He says, thy word have I hidden in my heart that I may not sin against thee. But Jesus tells us not to worry. And can I just ask Christ some questions? Christ, how can you tell me not to worry about my life? How can you tell me not to worry how I'm going to provide for my kids? Christ, how can you tell me not to worry about my health? How can you tell me not to worry when I've lost a family? Here's what Jesus is saying to you and I today. He said, I'm telling you not to worry simply because I will make a way. And I don't know if you know it today, but I just want to encourage your heart and your mind that God will make a way. Listen, I don't care where you find yourself in life. I serve a God who can do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think of. Christ said, don't worry because I will make a way. He says, I'll make a way. Listen, look at what he says in verse 24. He says, consider the reap. He says, they don't sow or reap. He said they don't have a storehouse, neither do they have a barn. And he said that God feeds them. And he said, how much of more value are you than the birds? And listen, I just come here to let you know that Jesus is saying that I take care of the birds. He said that I can take care of you too. Lord, will you fix my marriage? He said, if I did it for the birds, Lord, will you really bless my finances? He said, if I did it for the birds, Lord, will you really heal me in my broken places? He said, if I did it for the birds, Lord, will you heal my brokenness and my bitterness? He said that if I did it for the birds, all he's saying is that if he take care of the bird, he'll take care of you too. Listen, if he's dealing for the bird, I'm here to let you know you don't have nothing to worry about. But I like the way Tom Trippett said that. He said that if he did it before, that same God can do it again. Right? And he made a way before. That same God can make a way today. Every year broken is before. That same God can make a way out of no way. So the real question is, do you trust that God will make a way out of no way? Because I'm reminded of the song that asks us the questions, have you in the rivers that you think are uncrossable? He says, have you in the mountains that you can't tunnel through? Have you in the affliction that you think are in? And the doctor has done all they can do.
Yeah.
He says, but God specializes in these things.
Yeah.
In the things that seem to be impossible. Yeah. God specializes in these things. Yeah. And God will do what no other power can do. Jesus didn't only tell us not to worry. He then asked the question. He says, what you worried for? He says, in verse 25, he says, which one of you by worry can add a single moment to your life? And can I stop and ask you the same question that Christ asked his disciples? Which one of you in the house today, listen, can add a single moment until your life by worry? Jesus' concern for worry is, if worry does not add to your life, then worry sure will take away from your life. Listen, stress is a silent killer. Stress can damage your heart. So why spend your life worrying about the things in life that can do absolutely nothing about? Listen, things don't always go according to the way you planned it to be. But don't worry, because life goes on. And every round I go, it gets a little higher and higher. And every step I take, it gets a little better and better. Listen, I know you didn't plan for this moment right here. But don't worry, because life goes on. And every round I go in, it gets a little higher and higher. And every step I take, it gets a little better and better. Listen, I know you didn't want to hurt this moment, but don't worry, because life goes on. And every round I go, it gets a little higher and higher. And every step I take, it gets a little better and better. And I come to tell you today, don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Because God, let God fix it for you. If you want to know what I'm going to do now, let God fix it for you. If you want to know how can I make it, let God fix it for you. Don't worry, because life goes on. And every round I go, I get a little higher. I get a little higher. Every step I take, I get a little better and better. But Jesus said, don't worry. He said, what you're worried for. And listen, he said, when you find yourself worrying and beat down with life, he said, I got the solution for you. He said in verse number 31, that when you find yourself in a place of hurt and pain, he said that your solution is in verse number 31. He said, but seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added unto you. But I gotta let you know that when you fall in your place of worry, you gotta turn to Jesus.
Some of you are worried because mama is gone. Some are worried because grandmama is gone. Some is worried because friend is gone. But God says, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added unto you. So if you're wondering, how do I get to through this life worry free, you gotta seek ye first the kingdom of God, and God will take care of the rest. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and you can be worry free. Listen, they don't want to know how you gonna make it if mama is gone. You tell them, I'm gonna seek God. They don't wanna know how you gonna make it if grandmama is gone. You tell them, I'm gonna seek God. They don't wanna know how is the family gonna stick together when the glue is gone. You tell them, I'm going to seek God, how you're going to make it through your hurt, how you're going to make it through your pain. I know that I'm going to make it, because I'm going to seek God.
You find yourself in a place of pain. The only solution is to seek God. The only solution is to turn to God. Because there is not anything that you did that Christ had. Not anything that Christ didn't have to kneel before. But what I do know is that Christ is the only one who can fix it. Christ is the only one who can turn things around. Seek God. Seek God. Seek God. Amen.
Thank you. Worship. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.